Yeah. Thank you. to Cedar Bluff Baptist Church. I think I'm echoing a little bit.
Turn
back there.
Mic in front.
Hope you had a good week. Good and godly week. And the Lord bless you greatly. Did you ever have a bad day?
No.
You would never have a bad day. Yeah, actually, we all have some of those, but you know you're going to have a bad day when you wake up and your wife says, "Good morning, boy." His name's Bill. I hope. And then you get out on the highway going to school or work, and your horn on your car just starts beeping and it won't stop, and you realize that you're following a group of Hell's Angels motorcycle guys. It's going to be dangerous for your health. And then you get really upset and call the suicide hotline and they put you on hold. That's how you know that you are in trouble. But seriously, we all need prayer every day, and some days we really need it. And let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father, we do need you. All of us need you every day and every way and every second of the day. If we think we don't need you, something's going to happen to wake us up to the fact that we do. Sooner or later, that pride will be humbled and we'll recognize that we can't do it without you. Lord, we love you only because you first loved us and you gave yourself for us. Hear that much about us. We know that you allow troubles to come in our lives to mold us into your image, conform us to your image. Unfortunately, we need some of those. If it's always a sunshiny day for us, we become a desert spiritually, just the way we are. Lord, but we commit this day to you, and we thank you, Lord, that you love us and you don't let anything come in our lives that's not going to be worked together for good in the long run. Help us to believe that and trust you with it. Help us to be thankful to you for all the wonderful good blessings that you do give us. And we pray that you bless this time of worshiping you in spirit and in truth. Bless the music. That may be a pleasure to your ears and encouragement to ours. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So let's worship him in song, and then Bonnie and Niles for leading us this morning.
Okay, I need some singers to come help us for this. This first song, we're going to kind of do it New Orleans style. So, yeah, so get, you know, stand up and start swaying back and forth to kind of get in the rhythm of it. So, let's everybody stand. Y'all can grab some rhythm instruments. They're somewhere out there. I'm not sure what row they're on. Grab those tambourines and sticks, all kinds of stuff. So, yeah, so you might want to carry the swing and sway on this. Doing your work.
You better not put it back on.
Here we go.
I am a book down.
told the Yankees in New York, they made fun of my accent. I said, well, at least I know where yawning is. Ready? On the bright California with the very fresh alive and the glory of his resurrection shed.
My soul.
Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Heavenly Father, we pray that this morning we might be helped with this matter of worry, because this matter of worry matters. And we all deal with it, some more than others. Lord, help us with it in Jesus' name. Amen. Worry, anxietous feelings and thoughts. It's not just thoughts that Jesus is talking about. He's talking about anxietous, worried thoughts. And he specifically deals with several matters that we have a problem with. In verse 25, verse 31, verse 34, Jesus says what we're supposed to do about this. Very simple. Do not worry. Verse 25. Verse 31. Do not worry. Verse 34. Do not worry. But you know, some of these things are easier commanded than performed. We have a little more trouble when it comes down to the nitty-gritty of not worrying. And it's not that you're not supposed to have thoughts that have to do with a possible future out there. Foresight, making plans for what might take place and so on and so forth. But not fright-sight. Foresight, but not for fright. Not anxiety about it. Not living by fear. We worry about things like food. Verse 26. Now in those days they worried about the poor people anyway. The poor people today in many countries of the world, people don't have any idea where their food is going to come from the next day. We probably have never had that problem. I never have. I mean, even when we were dirt poor in college, we'd get calves liver and onions and peppers and fry them up, because that's the cheapest thing you could buy at that time. And, but, you know, we still didn't have it that bad. But he's primarily talking about people who are worried about where their next meal is going to come from. And we worry like rich folks regarding food. Paul tells us in 1 Timothy 4:4, for every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused if it is received with thanksgiving. And I'm bad about it. You know, I figure I'm supposed to take care of this body that God gave me, and so I try to do that, but I can get carried away. You know, you don't read the internet when it comes to warning you about what not to eat, because you will not eat anything. Nothing. I mean, something's wrong with everything. But we can overdo it, and we can eat things we know are bad for us in general. We can eat things that we know are bad for us in particular. My mind found out recently she's diabetic, and so the old sugar bag had to come off, so to speak. If you're going to take care of it, God expects you to take care of what he's given you. And sometimes we don't do that. But these folks were just talking about worrying with regard to just having something in your belly, empty in there, some food. Not worried about the nutritional value, how many vitamins and minerals and so on. Just give me something to eat. But God cares. And God says to cast all our cares upon him. He says there in verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And he says, seek me first, and I will provide all the food you need. Now, it may not always be the food you want, but he'll provide all the food you need. And we're not supposed to be worried about that. Clothes. feeds the little sparrows, and he clothes the lilies of the field, it says. You look at the flowers, just the wildflowers out there in the fields. Goldenrod right now doesn't look too beautiful. It's running down my throat. It's not fun. You look at the beautiful flowers, even the little teeny ones, and it's amazing. Now, how's that thing turn red? How's that thing turn blue? How's that thing turn purple? How is it possible that these flowers just come up and they're gorgeous? And they don't ever spin any cloth, they don't weave, they don't dye anything. They just come up looking gorgeous. And God did that. And he says, he cares more about you than he does the little birds, and he goes to all of their funerals. He cares more about you than he does about those little wildflowers out in the field. And so worrying about clothing, again, we don't worry about clothing like poor people do. My dad grew up in the Great Depression on a farm in New York State, upstate New York. I remember him telling about, it gets cold up there, 20 below zero at times. And they had horizontal runs of stovepipe. And to get some heat through the house, he said, you'd wake up in the morning and one of them would be on fire, bright red. You have to knock it loose, get the fire out, you know. I mean, we'd be afraid to sleep one night in a house like that. But, they had nine kids, so he didn't ever know about a pair of pants that didn't have patches or holes in it. And you know, I never understood why it bothered him so much when it was the style to have patches on your pants. And I'm glad he didn't live long enough to know about the holes in the jeans. He made more for them because there's holes in them. That's been going on for a while. But we worry about clothes like rich folk, being in style, having the latest and the greatest. And he's talking about poor folks that just want something to keep them from freezing to death in the winter. And maybe look good enough to go to church without holes. It's a different mindset. At any rate, we worry about different things. Probably dumber things, but still, this matter of worry can grab a hold of anybody. Bell bottoms are back. Can you believe it? I waited 50 years. And then they go around in a cycle. They go around in a cycle, and that cycle took a long time to come back for obvious reasons. But yeah, I'm not going to wear them this time around. But anyway, the things we get all enthused about and worried about. But you know, I think the biggest thing that we worry about is a thing called tomorrow. Verse 34, therefore do not worry about tomorrow. God gives us grace, enabling power to deal with today's troubles. But then we borrow heavy sacks of troubles from tomorrow, bring them over into today. He didn't give us grace to deal with junk that hadn't even happened. And he doesn't give us grace today to deal with things that already happened. He gives us grace today to deal with what's happening today. And he says, sufficient for the day is its own trouble. And if I could just learn that one, if any of us, if all of us could just learn that one. And it's a battle, and I'll say a few more things about that in a minute. But tomorrow, God knows what we need. He knows there needs to be some rain in our lives that will make our flowers, spiritual flowers, grow. He knows that the way we're constructed and the way we sinned against him, and we're in cursed bodies and we're in a cursed world, and he knows that if we have all sunshine, we will become a desert spiritually. Now, heaven's not going to be like that. It won't have to be like that because we won't be like we are now. But in this world, Unfortunately, from a spiritual standpoint, it takes some trouble for our own good. But we can be absolutely certain that God is not going to bring any trouble in our lives except that which will be used to conform us into his image. And in the end, he's spiritually good for us. And I know that takes faith, doesn't it? It certainly takes faith. It certainly takes faith. Sometimes I get pretty puny on it, but I know it's true, and I know it works. It matters of worry, it matters we worry about. And then there's the malignancy of worry. In verse 27, it says, which of you by worry can, add one cubit to his stature? You can't make yourself 1 inch taller or make your life last 1 day longer in this world by worry. It doesn't do any good. When will we get the point that it doesn't do any good? In fact, it does bad. Chronic worry can really hurt your health, hurt your relationships, your sleep, your job performance. You'll start overeating, cigarette smoking, using alcohol and drugs, trying to feel better. What happens is we're afraid of something when there's nothing there to be afraid of. We get the fight or flight response, and all of these hormones are released like cortisol into our systems, and they're needed, adrenaline and so on. They're needed when we're in a tight situation, and God made it that way. But when we're manufacturing tight situations 24/7, by our anxieties thinking, we end up destroying our health by pumping these junky hormones into our system, and it can result in suppression of the immune system, digestive disorders, muscle tension, short-term memory loss, premature coronary artery disease, heart attack, and so on and so forth. And truly, when we worry, we are living like the heathen. He says that's what the Gentiles or ungodly people do in verse 32. For after all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. Good old worry, bad old worry, does so much harm emotionally, physically. And it grieves God, too, because what it amounts to is we don't believe him. We don't want to admit it. But he says in verse 30, now, if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown in the oven, will he not much more clothe you and feed you and take care of you, O you of little faith? O you of little faith. We don't believe it. He says all things work together for good to those that love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. But we don't like his purpose making. We don't believe his purpose is best. And we would like our purpose better. And we really, really want our purpose to be the purpose. And we would like God to adopt our purpose. And he says, no, you've got to adopt my purpose. And my purpose is better. And sometimes down the road when we look back, we say, yeah, his purpose was better. But during it, during that time of pain and trouble, awful hard to think his purpose is good and that all things are going to work together for good. That doesn't mean all things are good. It means they're all going to work together for good. He's going to take them. He's going to put them. It's like a painting where there are places that if you just focus in on one spot on that painting, it's black paint. All you'll see is darkness. There's nothing to see there except something ugly, awful, gray, dark. But when those dark spots and the beautiful colors and everything blends together, it makes this beautiful piece of art that wouldn't be the same. It wouldn't be as beautiful if it wasn't for the dark spots. So, like St. Augustine said, that's how we need to look at the painting of our life. That all of that needs to be there in order to make what God, the masterpiece that God wants to make. It does look good. It does harm. It's contagious. Worry steals our strength. You know, the Bible tells us in Psalm 103:14, He knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. God knows us. He made us. He knows what we are prepared by Him to handle, and He knows what we aren't. And so, again, like I said before, if we borrow the weight of worry and carry around things from the past to the future instead of just dealing with them today, then that weight will just destroy our strength and take us down. This dock worker in New Orleans was working on the Mississippi River and was loading a ship. Something happened with one of the pieces of boards of the dock, and he ended up falling in the river. He went down the first time, he came up, "Will you help me?" He went down the second time, he came up, "Please help me." And the third time he goes down and he comes back up, he says, "If somebody doesn't help me, I'm going to have to drop one of these anvils I'm holding on to." But that's us, isn't it? We're holding on to these anvils of anxiety and thoughts about the future. What's going to happen? What's going to happen to my grandbaby? What's going to happen to this? What's going to happen to that? It hasn't happened, and it won't happen today. That's the future. Today, what's happened? Today, what do I deal with? Today, what do I think about? It's really hard. And I've struggled with this over the years, and I've looked at a passage of scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Okay, every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. How can I possibly do that? Well, you know, Jesus doesn't tell you to do something that He doesn't give you the grace to do. God doesn't command us to do things that we cannot do. So if He says, bring every thought into captivity through Christ, then we can do that. And I've never been very good at it, to be honest. But lately, you know, I've realized, and here I am, I'm 70 and having to learn new stuff. But it never ends. But you know when a thought comes in. You just stop and realize it. When a thought comes in and it's an anxious thought about something coming up supposedly 3 days from now, a week from now, or 2 weeks from now. And you see it coming and you're going to meditate on it and start feeling terrible, start feeling worried, start feeling anxious. Say, whoa, no. That's future. That hadn't happened. That may never happen. It doesn't exist. I'm not going to mess with you. And then you feel one from the past. You never did what you should have done. And you, quit. No. I'm not going to think about that. That's past. That's done for. I'm concentrating on that. Today, what do I have to deal with today? What trouble do I have today? What am I supposed to do today? And it does help. You can. It's amazing. God's word is true. We can do it. But it has to be a good fight of faith. And believing God and just catching those thoughts and bringing them into captivity. And obedience to Christ. So that worry, it steals our strength, and it buries our blessings. Adrian Rogers had a couple come to with their little baby to his office for counseling, and they came in, and they looked very weighed down with worry and fretting, and they come in, And they sit down and he said, well, what's troubling you? You seem to be just under a weight. The young man said, I am so worried. I lost my job. I can't seem to find one. I'm just so tied up in knots and worried that I can't sleep. I can't eat. I can't do anything. I can't think straight. And Andrew Rogers said to him, well, let me ask you, how's your health? And he said, my health's great, you know, except for this worry stuff. And he said, do you realize that many people who have banks full of money would give it all to have good health? Well, how's your relationship with your wife? Oh, we love each other so much. We're so thankful that we came together. And it's just, she's so great. And she said, he's so great. You know how many people would give everything they've got in order to have a happy marital relationship? He said, how about this little baby of yours? Oh, we love our little guy. Man, he's the apple of our eye. What a blessing. He said, do you know how many couples would give anything to have a little child of their own? He said, you need to start looking at the blessings and the things that God has given you rather than the things that you don't have. And then leave the rest of it in God's hands by faith, and he's going to take care of it. Again, we're not talking about something that is easy all the time, but you can see how this young couple was in misery when they could have been praising God for having each other and having their health and having their baby. You know, we've got to focus on the right things. And worry is often a self-fulfilling prophecy. Job said in Job 3:25, the thing I greatly feared has come upon me, and what I dreaded has happened to me. It's weird, and I can't explain it completely, but there's a sense in which when you're worried about something, it's almost like you're praying that it would happen. I mean, you're just focusing on that thing until it's like a prayer. Yeah, what happened to me? No, we don't want to be destroyed by the malignancy of worry. It does no good. It harms. It steals strength. It buries blessings. And it's sometimes a self-fulfilling prophecy. No, we want to have mastery over worry, a mastery of worry. So, matters of worry, the malignancy of worry, and the mastery over worry. In verses 33 and 34, how you do it is seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and be provided with everything that you need. And then do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow can worry about itself. You got plenty to deal with today. Mastery over worry. When he says don't, you can don't. When he says don't, you can don't. Does that make any sense to you? He says don't worry, you can don't worry. So I think one of our main difficulties with this is that we don't really believe that we can overcome something like worry. We don't believe we can do it. And we can't. We can't. We don't have to keep disobeying God and not believing God and doing that. We need to trust our Father. Says your Father already knows you need these things in verse 32. When I was a kid, we didn't have a great deal. Dad was an auto body man and manager of body shops. And but do you know I never in mom stayed home. I don't remember ever once worrying about whether there'd be food to eat. Because I trusted my dad. I knew he'd do it. Now, really, later I learned that God's the ultimate provider and we need to trust him. But we just, if you had that kind of a dad that you could trust, and you believed he'd do everything humanly possible to take care of you, you're blessed. And if you didn't, you always had the Heavenly Father ready to provide for you. But if we could just trust our Heavenly Father, who loves us a great deal more than our earthly father, and who's a great deal more capable than our earthly father to take care of us, and just trust him like we trusted our earthly father to take care of us, our earthly mother and father. Matthew 10:31. Do not fear, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. The Lord knows how many hairs on our heads, and some are easier to count than others, all that, but he knows us inside and out, upside and down, and we can trust him to take care of us. Now, we need to have the right priorities. We need to have the right priorities. Notice in verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. First. We have a bad habit of putting jobs and hobbies and sports and pleasures and entertainments, everything before him. And he's just kind of dangling a rope behind us and bouncing on the ground. It's kind of later, way later in the game. Everything else matters more than him. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. It's not that you don't have your hobbies, it's not that you don't have your entertainment, it's not that you don't have your fun, but you never put these things above God. Now, Bonnie's dad always loved quail hunting, bird hunting. And how many of you have ever been bird hunting? There's hardly any quail around anymore, unfortunately. But it wasn't because of the bird hunt. But anyway, he got me doing it. You know, a son-in-law had it. And it was fun. But you know, he really liked it. Anyway, he could tell you, if it was several months of bird season, he could tell you how many weeks and how many days and how many hours until it opened. But he didn't hunt on Sunday. And if the church had something going on Saturday, he didn't hunt that Saturday. He'd have killed it. I mean, he put the Lord and what was going on with the Lord's folks first. And that was his favorite verse, too. Matthew 6:33, seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these things shall be added unto you. First. And Thomas Shuford came with Michael a few weeks ago. Some of you were here and probably remember the gentleman that came in, kind of a gray haired fellow. Thomas was carried to church, Sunday school and church, by his dad every Sunday for years. Go by and pick him up at his house and bring him to Sunday school and church. See, first. It's basically God says, you take care of my business, I'll take care of yours. You take care of my business, I'll take care of yours. You put my business first, I'll take care of your business. Makes good sense. When the storms come, we need to go to our Father. Here's two things that you don't need to worry about. Don't worry about the things that you can do something about. Do whatever it is you can do about. And don't worry about the things that you can't do anything about. And that's everything. That takes care of everything. If you can do something about it, don't worry about it, do it. If you can't do anything about it, don't worry about it. Leave it in God's hands. You refuse. You have to refuse to worry about it. You really do. you're listening for diagnosis of some symptoms that you have. And another thing, don't go online and find out all the diseases that you might have that you probably don't have. There, you're waiting for that diagnosis. And it's hard not to worry about it. But it's not going to help one little teeny, weeny, itsy bitsy bit. Don't worry about it. But trust God and deal with today. Let God take care of tomorrow. This ship was in the middle of the ocean. There was a terrible storm going on. It was in the olden days. And some of the sailors were down in the hole under the water line, and they were trying to plug holes in the ship to keep it from sinking. One of them got so worried, so distraught, so anxious that he just climbed up the ladder and he ran to the pilot house and he saw the captain at the wheel in the pilot house there. He saw him from the back and threw the door open, and the captain just sort of looked around over his shoulder and smiled at him. And he went back down to the hold of the ship. He told his buddies, "I've been to the pilot house, the captain's at the wheel," and he smiled at me. "Everything's going to be okay." And so when we get in the midst of it, we need to go to the captain, and we need to see the smile on his face that says, "It's going to be okay." It's part of his. And it is going to be okay if we know the captain, if we know the Father. If our home is heaven, if he's in control of your life here, then it's going to be okay. No matter what happens, it's going to be okay, because we're going to be with him. Sing with me, we're going to sing a little invitation. You're welcome to come forward, pray, pray with you. If you need to be saved, if you've never come to Christ, just admit that you're a sinner, ask Jesus to come into your life, and give you a new life, and make you a new creature in him, and give you eternal life with him, and forgive you, and he'll do it. You may have some other reason to come to the altar just to pray about something. About this worry thing, Lord, help me to actually do this, because this worry is weighing me down and it's ridiculous. You will help. This week. Uh-huh. sing happy birthday.